Hello everyone, welcome to the Secrets of Calculus. This is the moment we've all been waiting for. We can finally ditch these weird tables that I've been using to show how cool limits are. After this episode, you'll be able to show off your power of limits for yourself. Oh wait, is this video too long? Don't worry, this is a recap of all the previous TLDRs. But do be prepared to add this to your toolbox. And do let me know what you did with that extra free time. So first, we need to make a definition. I'm defining big braining as where you take shortcuts and formulas to find an answer. I call it big braining because you're able to find answers super fast. If you're in high school algebra, you'll know the greatest shortcuts to finding avoided values, aka horizontal asymptotes. You can manage forbidden values, aka vertical asymptotes. You can define continuity and do lots of other things. So let's start putting together a how to solve limits flowchart. We start with the problem, find the limit as x approaches a value of a function. Step one, just plug in the value. Seriously, sometimes limits can be just that easy. Now, if you have a piecewise function and the value you're approaching is the intersection of multiple pieces, you're going to need to take step 1a instead. In this case, we're saying that approaching the value is the same as equaling. Now, think of the limit as a safety rope. Even if you end up dividing by zero, it's not going to create a black hole, because you can just as easily say approaching zero is not the same as equaling zero. Now, here's the thing. If you end up with a situation where you might be dividing by zero after you take step 1 or step 1a, move on to step 2. And step 1a, for piecewise functions where the value is the intersection of the functions, you can find the limit as x approaches from above and below, plug in the value into each function that's intersecting, and see if they equal each other. If they don't, move on to step 2. Step 2. If step 1 didn't work, your function is not continuous. I feel sorry for you, because things are about to get complicated. In this step, do as much algebra as possible and cancel out as much as you can. For example, if you have x minus 1s in the numerator and denominator, cancel them out. Then try step 1 again with this modified function. And here, we're saying approaching is not the same as equaling, and then after the algebra, saying that approaching is the same as equaling. Sneaky, sneaky. If you still find yourself with a situation where you're dividing by zero, proceed to step 3. If your limit is approaching infinity or negative infinity, this step should be about breaking out the sledgehammer, followed by step 3a. And now, this is the sledgehammer. If you have a fraction, do this. This is basically multiplication by a fancy version of the number 1, so you're not really breaking any rules by doing this. Just make the 3 in the fancy fraction equal to the highest exponent of the equation. So if the numerator was an x to the 4th, the fancy version of 1 should be 1 over x to the 4th, all divided by 1 over x to the 4th in the fancy fraction. If you have square roots, say the numerator says square root of x to the 6th plus 1, you can replace the top part of the fancy fraction with 1 over square root of x to the 6th. It's the same as saying 1 over x cubed in the top, but now you can use square root properties to sneak it into the square root. Now when you go through with this multiplication, you should get something like this. And I might as well cover step 3a right now, because we just used the sledgehammer. Use the fact that any constant divided by infinity is zero. So if you have an x in the denominator of a fraction, and your limit is approaching one of the infinities, make that fraction a zero right now. Now, for these purposes, you can think of sine of x or cosine of x as constants. After all, they only go to 1 and negative 1. Just don't try that with tangent of x. Step 3. Chances are, if you got to this point and your limit is still not solved, you're probably working with a forbidden value. If it hasn't gone away yet, the answer is definitely going to be one of the infinities. As for which one, You're going to need to split the limit into an approaches from below and approaches from above. Buckle your seatbelts, because at this point, the numbers don't matter. All that matters is which parts are positive and which are negative. After that, we can use the multiplication and division of positives and negatives to figure out which infinity it is. So, here's an example. We're trying to find the limit as x approaches 0 of x squared over x cubed plus x to the fourth. So first, split the limit and identify what's positive and what's negative. So for this, I'm using the 0 plus and the 0 minus to indicate that you're approaching from above or below. This is pretty much just simplify the limit. So now we can see how the exponents interact. So a number that's negative to an even power becomes positive. So we can take advantage of that. And any positive number to any power is still going to be positive. And so the first equation here has a plus at the end, which shows that we're going to get a positive number. So the limit as x approaches 0 from above is positive infinity. Now, the second equation, we have a conflict in the approach from below case. So to resolve this, we need to proceed to step 4. Step 4, you're probably working with approaching a forbidden value that leads to an answer of infinity. So for this, we're going to have to brute force this by picking a number really close to what we're trying to approach and plugging it into the equation. For example, let's choose x equals negative 0.001. And when we find it out, we end up with negative 1,999. Again, the number doesn't matter. All that matters if it's positive or negative. Here, it's negative. So the limit as x approaches 0 from below is negative infinity. And that's the flowchart. It's kind of a mess, but if you reach the end and you still find multiple answers, the limit doesn't exist. But really, step 1 is what you'll be doing most often, and you almost have to rig the function in order to get all the way to step 4. Something interesting emerges. Step 1 reveals the magic behind the limit, showing that it basically works like a function finding a value at a certain x. So the stuff we can do to functions, we can also do to the limit. Now, when you're adding or subtracting functions, you get the same answer no matter if you add the functions and then find the value, or find the two values and then add them together. Isn't that convenient? So the limit also distributes over addition and subtraction. And it's the same way with multiplication and division. This is why I called the limit the chillest operator you'll ever see. But wait! There's more. You can also have compound functions like f of g of x, and then plugging that into the input for f of x. The limit can do this too, but only if f of x is continuous at the point x equals c. So the limit can sneak past functions if they're continuous. Isn't that cool? There's one more tool called squeeze theorem that we can add to a toolbox of shortcuts. But it's going to take some explaining. The idea is that if you have two other functions that equal the one in question at x equals c, you can find the limit of the function in question by instead finding the limits of the two other functions. It's called the squeeze theorem because these other functions tend to look like boundaries for the function in question. Trig functions tend to be the most common examples because they are one of the messiest functions in existence. So let's see it in practice with the limit as x approaches infinity of f of x equals sine of x over x. Now, I'm aware that we can use the divide by infinity rule, but there aren't really any simple examples where squeeze theorem is the only way to find the answer, and I'll be banished if I don't show you this. First, we're going to assemble this function based on what we know. Sine of x bounces back and forth between y equals negative 1 and y equals 1. Since f of x is sine of x, but with dividing by x, we can just divide by x in each part of the inequality. Yeah, we just did some pretty serious big braining right here. It's also, in my opinion, the most complicated part of this whole process because it relies on your ability to see patterns in functions. But this is a good skill to develop, because now that we have an inequality where sine of x over x is bounded by two other functions, 1 over x and minus 1 over x, we can find the limits of these two boundary functions using a brand new flowchart. And we find that the limit as x approaches infinity of 1 over x is 0 approaching from above, and the limit as x approaches infinity of negative 1 over x is 0 approaching from below. And here we'll say that 0 from above is equal to 0 from below, which ultimately equals 0. So now we have this inequality to work with. And so this limit equals 0 because the only number between 0 and 0 is, well, 0. So there you go. The limit is the chillest operator ever because it lets you do things that you normally are unable to do, while still distributing through addition, subtraction, multiplication, division, and compounding. Plus, if trig is giving you a headache, you can use squeeze theorem to try to simplify. The best part is that you're not required to use these shortcuts if you don't want to. Now we have a flowchart of how to solve limits and the know-how of big braining an answer. However, if we blindly follow the flowchart, we might end up falling into a trap. Here's one of those traps. The limit as x approaches infinity of 1 plus 2 over x, all that to the x. See if you could solve this. Try the big braining approach, and then try the brute force approach. See you next time!